So this is a proof. We are in Roma because we will finish with Angela Pistoia from the University of Roma. And she's going to talk on critical Lane-Emden systems. So please, Angela.
Okay, so I will, this is the title, this is my slides. Okay, first of all, okay, the first slide is about Roma. I wish you were here for this nice talk. And it is like if you were here. And I would like to thank Alberto, Benedetta, and Francesca for this kind invitation. I am really happy to be here. Okay, so let me speak about, let me introduce the problem. The problem I am interested in is this problem here in the blue box. This is minus delta u equal v to the some power p plus something which is small, and minus delta v equal to u to some power q with something which is small, and u and v are zero on the boundary of omega. Here omega is a smooth bounded domain in Rn. Epsilon is a small positive parameter. Alpha, beta 1, and beta 2 are real numbers. And pq, p and q, which are the exponent of the nonlinearities, are the pair pq lies on the critical hyperbola. Okay, so this is the system I would like to address. And let me tell you two special cases. The first case is when p is equal q to the critical, and they are both equal to the critical exponent. And in this case, this system reduced to the single equation, okay? This is the, you can recognize the classical Brzezinski-Nirenberg problem. E epsilon b is small. The second special case is when q is equal one. Then if you plug here q equal one, what you get is that p is n plus four over n minus four, which is a critical exponent for the Laplacian. So in this case, the system reduced to the fourth order critical problem I wrote here. This is critical. Here there is a perturbation term, linear perturbation term, and we have a Navier boundary condition, okay? Now I will focus on the Brzezinski-Nirenberg problem, and because there are something which I would like to complete, okay? So I will focus on the classical Brzezinski-Nirenberg problem, and let me tell you something which is very well known, but it will be useful to remind it. Okay, so this is the Brzezinski-Nirenberg problem. And it is well known that the existence of solutions strongly depends on the geometry of omega and on the sign of beta. Remember that epsilon is a small positive parameter. And in particular, the Poiseuille identity tells that there are no solutions if omega is a star-shaped domain and beta, this number beta here, is less or equal than zero. And so a positive solution exists if and only if this epsilon beta, this small quantity here, is positive and it is strictly less than lambda one, capital lambda one of omega, where capital lambda one is the first eigenvalue of minus Laplacian with the homogeneous Dirichlet boundary condition. Okay, this second result was obtained in the paper by Brzezinski and Nirenberg. Okay, and this is true, this condition epsilon beta is less than capital lambda one is true when n is greater than equal to four. Okay, so this is the classical situation for the Brzezinski-Nirenberg problem. What can we say for the system? Okay, the system can be seen like a generalization of the Brzezinski-Nirenberg problem. Okay, to this. Okay, so the first result is a non-existence result when the domain omega is star-shaped and this matrix here is a negative semi-definite. This result can be obtained via a generalized quasi-safe identity obtained by in a series of paper, which are study, mitigate, and back the forces. And in particular, you see that when P and Q are greater than one and alpha is zero, the fact that this matrix is negative definite, it means that beta 1 and beta 2 are less or equal than 0. So this is the natural generalization to what happens for the Bredesen-Nierenberg problem to this kind of Hamiltonian system. Okay, and what can we say about the existence of solution? Well, Alshoff and Mitidieri and van der Voorst prove that when P and Q are greater than 1, alpha is 0 and both beta 1 and beta 2 are positive, there is a positive solution when this quantity here, epsilon squared, beta 1 and beta 2, is less than capital lambda 1 squared of omega, where capital lambda 1 is the first eigenvalue of minus delta with Dirichlet boundary condition. Again, there are some extra conditions on the dimension n, which depends on p and q. But again, this is the natural extension of what happened for the single equation. Let me say something about the proof, the argument of Alshoff, Mitidieri, and van der Voorst. They use this point of view. Okay, solution to this problem, our system. Remember that in their case, alpha is zero, are critical points of this strongly indefinite function. Okay, here you see that there is this term which is strongly, which causes a lot of troubles. In the subcritical regime, when the pair PQ is below the critical hyperbola, one can use an indefinite functional theorem due to Bencher-Rabinowitz or topological methods. Okay, and here are the authors which studied the problem when P and Q is below the critical hyperbola. But there are two problems. One is the Pallesnell condition, and one is the fact that this approach requires the compactness of the gradient of the non-quadratic part, okay? Which fails in the critical case. That is why they use a dual formulation due to Clark and Detela. This is not necessary in the case of the single equation. This is the approach used by Alshoff, Mitidieri, and van der Voorst. Okay? And I would like also to quote another approach which follows the idea of Pierre-Louis Lyons, for which this system, in this case, in the first equation, there is no a perturbative term. All the perturbation is in the second equation. Okay, in this case, this system can be reduced to an higher order single equation. Okay, you can find V from the previous equation, from the first equation, you put this V in the second equation, and what you get is this higher order single equation. And the solution to this higher order single equation are nothing but the critical points of this function, of this energy, which is defined on this space. Okay, this second approach in the subcritical regime has been successfully used by Benibonere, Ederson, Moreira, Dos Santos, Miguel Ramos, and also Gutavarish in the subcritical regime. This is another point of view which is very powerful. Okay, now what happens in the critical situation? In the critical situation, we can find solution is difficult, as everybody knows, in the critical setting. But in this case, one can find, as in the Bredesen-Nierenberg problem, a least energy positive solution, which is obtained by minimizing the J on the LQ plus one sphere, unit sphere. Okay, so what we can get is a least energy positive solution obtained in this way. Now, a natural question is, what happens when the epsilon goes to zero? We take the least energy solution and let us see what happens when this epsilon goes to zero. Well, Ignacio Guerra studied the asymptotic profile of the least energy positive solution, okay, which is obtained minimizing this functional J on the sphere and on the unit sphere in L Cooper's. And what he found was the following: the U epsilon and its Laplacian, its Laplacian minus delta U epsilon to the power 1 over P, namely the V epsilon. So the two components blew up at the same point in omega axis star. And if you look around the blow up point, what you find is a solution to the limit problem in the whole space. More precisely, the two components around the blow up point can be scaled in a suitable way so that they look like capital U, capital V, and capital U, capital V is the unique positive radial solution of this problem in the whole space. Blow up, the U epsilon, the epsilon blow up means that they go to zero everywhere except at the maximum point, xi star, where they go to plus infinity. Okay, and here it is said in a more precise way. Here the concentration parameter mu depends on epsilon and goes to zero, and here the maximum point, the concentration point xi, depend on epsilon and approach the blow up point xi star. Okay. Now, this is what happens for the system, and this is what happened also for the Bredesen-Rehmer problem. Indeed, Han and Ray took the least energy positive solution found by Bredesen-Rehmer and studied the asymptotic profile when epsilon goes to zero. And they found the same result. The solution U epsilon, now we have only one component, blows up at the point xi star in omega. And if you look around the blow up point, what you see in a suitable way, so you have to take the maximum point xi, you scale in a suitable way with this mu, and what you get is a solution to the critical problem in the whole space. Okay? So again, what you see around the critical points is a bubble, a solution to this critical problem in RN. Now, what Anne and Ray also proved is that the concentration point xi star, where the solution is blowing up, is a critical point of this Robbins function R of X. What is the Robbins function? It is well known. It is defined in this way. You take G, the Green's function of minor delta with the Dirichlet boundary condition. The Green function has a singular part and the regular part. H, X, Y is the regular part. You evaluate the regular part at the diagonal, and what you get is the Robbins function. So what is true for the Bredesen-Rehmer problem is that if you take the least energy solution, it blows up at a critical point of the Robbins function and far away, and the solution looks like a bubble. Now, having in mind this situation, for the Bredesen-Rehmer problem, it is possible to build a bunch of blowing up solution, positive or sun changing, using the Lyapunov-Schmidt procedure. Indeed, this was done in a series of papers, but what it is important is to understand how this kind of solution have been built. The shape of these solutions close to each blow up point xi I star looks like a positive or a negative bubble, remember that the bubble is a solution to the critical problem in the whole space. And so close to each lower point, the solution looks like a positive bubble when Si is plus one, or a negative bubble if the Si is equal to minus one. The concentration parameters mu I looks like a suitable concentration at the limit, looks like a mu I star and goes to zero as epsilon goes to zero. The concentration point xi I the epsilon looks like at the limit this xi one xi I star. And this is not true for any possible choice of xi one star and xi I star. Indeed, what it is possible to prove using the Lyapunov-Schmidt procedure can be stated in the following way. Let us consider this strange guy here in the gray box written in green. Well, if you take this reduced, this is called reduced energy. This reduced energy depends on mu I concentration parameter, xi I concentration point. Well, if we take a critical point of this energy, then you can find, when epsilon is small enough, a solution to the Brzezinski-Nirenberg equation, which blows up positively or negatively at the point xi star. Okay, this is the complicated pattern to understand, but this is not difficult, I mean, to build using this Lyapunov-Schmidt procedure. Okay, one remark here, I write the reduced energy. The reduced energy is nothing but the energy of the bubble, of the sum of the bubble. The contribution of each blow up point is given by the Robin function. The interaction between different blow up points is given in terms of the Green's function, and it is positive if the two bubbles have the same sign, or it is negative if they have different sign. Okay, this epsilon term here comes from this term here. Okay, and since the bubble does not belong to L2 when n is equal to 4, what I wrote here is the expansion when n is greater than equal to 5. But it is not important. Okay, just a remark, when k is equal to 1, only one blow up point, the reduced energy looks like this guy here. And it is clear that if I take a stable critical point of the Robin function, stable means a minimum or a maximum or a non-degenerate critical point, then the reduced energy has again a stable critical point, because we can always minimize in mu, and so I can get the solution. Okay, this is a compressed version of the existence of blowing up solution for the Brzezinski. Okay, now you can imagine what I want to do. What I ask is the following. Let us consider our initial Hamiltonian system with this linear perturbation. Okay, well, is it possible to build positive and sign-changing solution to this system, which blows up at different points in omega and was shaped around each blow-up point, looks like a positive or a negative bubble. So I would like to repeat what I can do for the Brzezinski-Nirenberg problem for this linear perturbation of the Lane-Emden system. Okay, it is clear that this is possible if I can find a good reduced energy and if I can repeat all what I did for the Brzezinski-Nirenberg problem. Okay, this was the question. And the answer is positive, and it was obtained in collaboration with, this is a result obtained in collaboration with Shang-Kyok Kim from the Nankai University. Let me state the result in the simplest case of the, which concern the existence of a one-point blowout. Okay, so this is the system. If epsilon is small enough, I can find a solution which blows up at the point x star in omega. If one among beta 1, alpha, or beta 2 are strictly positive. Okay, so if beta 1 is strictly positive, or beta 1 is 0 and alpha is strictly positive, or beta 1 and alpha are 0, and then beta 2 is strictly positive. This is the assumption we have. The shape around the block point resembles the bubble, the solution to the limit problem in the Bohr space, and mu star, xi star, mu star epsilon is the limit of the concentration parameter, xi star is the blow-up point. Well, this mu star, xi star, has to be a stable critical point of this reduced energy. And now the situation is, the situation is really complicated because we have, this is different from what happened in the case of the Bergis-Nirenberg problem. And I will see, I will show you why in a moment. First of all, the reduced energy depends on P. If P is, let me say, close to one, if P is close to the critical exponent, well, more or less we have what we had for the Bergis-Nirenberg problem. So the concentration points are critical points of the Robin function. But if P is close to one, the concentration point is not a critical point of the Robin function, but it is a critical point of a more involved function R tilde. I don't know if I have time to introduce this R tilde, but what I can tell you is that this R tilde is a function which always has a minimum in any domain as long as it exists. Indeed, you see here there is a gap. I don't have this result when P is between n minus 1 over n minus 2 and n over n minus 2 because I don't know if the function R tilde is irregular or not. And due to the procedure, to the Dyapunov-Schmidt procedure, I cannot deal with this case. So there is this problem. Okay, so this is our result for one blow-up point. We also give an abstract result, which allows us to find blowing up solutions via the existence of the critical points of reduced energy, which rules the location of the concentration point and the rate of concentration parameter. So we can give the reduced energy in any for any choice for any choice of blowing up two blowing up points, three, four, whatever you want. But it is extremely difficult to find critical points of the reduced energy, even in the more in the easiest case of one positive and one negative peak. It is extremely difficult and the problem is completely open. Okay, now I don't know how far, how much time do I have because I get lost. So maybe 10 minutes or
yeah,
or
you
10 minutes, I think.
Sorry, this mute is silly. You can talk until 5 and 10, so you still have 10 minutes.
Okay, thank you. Okay, now let me tell you how the proof goes. Okay, our proof relies on the classical five-dimensional Dyapunov-Schmidt reduction. The steps are exactly the same we have always used. But in our situation, every step is extremely difficult and it requires a lot of technicalities. Okay, in order to perform the Dyapunov-Schmidt reduction, there are two, I would say, three important ingredients. The first ingredient is the non-degeneracy of the bubbles. Yesterday, Begonia Barros told you something about this fact. The second step is finding a good answers. Now, Antonio, in his talk, found an answer which was extremely difficult. Now the situation is difficult, but not so difficult. And the third step is about the choice of the functional space, okay? I don't have time to discuss all these steps. I will give you some hints about the non-degeneracy of the bubbles, because in order to prove the non-degeneracy, we use in a crucial way the ODE techniques. So I think that this is, this encounters the topic of the workshop, ODE versus PDE and vice versa. Okay, so let me go to the non-degeneracy of the bubbles. Okay, so here I'm living in the wall space. So I have a solution to this system, to this Hamiltonian system in the wall space Rn. Pierre-Louis proved that the solution to this system are weak solution to this single equation. And he found a solution, a ground state solution, by minimizing, okay? So I can always find a solution. And this ground state solution is positive, is radially symmetric, and it is unique up to dilations and translations. So all the positive solution to our system are obtained by translation and by dilation using the unique positive solution to this system, which takes capital U takes the maximum at zero and the maximum is equal to one. This was proved by in a series of papers. Here you can find the references. So I use this result, the invariance of the system under dilation and translations, to produce solutions to the linear problem. This is exactly in the spirit of Begonia talk, okay? So these functions here solve these systems. Now, it is clear that if you take the derivative with respect to mu and the derivative with respect to xi, you get a solution to the linear system. It is just by the derivation. So how many derivatives do I have? One derivative with respect to mu and n derivatives with respect to the points. Remember that the point xi lives in the wall space of n. So I have at least n plus one solution which are linearly independent of this linear system. Now we say that the solution u v, the bubble, is non-degenerate if any other solution to this linear system is a linear combination of the zi. Okay? And as Bego said, it is extremely important to understand if the bubble is non-degenerate or not. So the question is the bubble non-degenerate? And the answer is yes, it is non-degenerate. And this is a result obtained in collaboration with Rupert, Frank, Shenkyok Kim, and myself. So all the solution to these linear systems are linear combination of the zeta I wrote before. How can we obtain this result? And this is the connection, the strong connection with ODE. Indeed, okay, first of all, we can assume using the invariance that u and v are radially symmetric, and so we will focus on this linear system. Okay, so what we want to prove is that this linear system has a kernel which is generated by n plus one n plus one functions which are linearly independent, the functions I wrote before. How can we do? We perform an angular momentum decomposition of capital psi and capital phi, and then we study by employing delicate ODE techniques the radial parts. This is what we did. And here it is written more or less what I'm telling you. So capital psi is written this way. The red part is the radial part. The blue part is given in terms of the spherical harmonics in L2. They are the eigenfunction of the Laplace-Beltrami operator in Sn-1. The same for phi, capital phi. Okay, now, so the capital Y, Lm, is an eigenfunction of minor delta into Sn minus one, is an eigenfunction. The eigenvalues is mu L. And let me tell you that when L is equal to zero, the first eigenvalue is zero, and the multiplicity of the this eigenvalue is one, and the corresponding eigenfunction is the constant. Okay, when L is equal to one, I mean the second eigenvalue has multiplicity n, and the corresponding eigenfunctions are the coordinate functions. Okay, they are n. Having in mind this, now let us look at the system solved by the red functions, which are the radial parts. And what we do, we write the system, and what we do is the following. This is very painful. It is very nice to write, but it is extremely painful to prove that when n is equal to zero, the unique all the solutions to this problem are a multiple of this guy here. And this guy is nothing but the derivative of the bubble with respect to the concentration parameter. This is radial. Okay. When n is equal to one, then all the solutions to this problem are a multiple of u prime v prime. And this is gives you the n derivatives of the bubbles with respect to the points. This comes from the translation by the invariance by translations. And finally, when L is greater equal than two, then the unique solution is the trivial one. So using this result and constructing an answer, which is very painful. I don't have time to write. I think I can stop here because it's late, and thank you for your attention.